Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Paradise Lost, A Life of F. Scott Fitzgerald, by David S. Brown. Narrated by David Colacci. With the end of winter set in another pleasant, pump-dry period, and while I took a little time off, a fresh picture of life in America began to form before my eyes. The uncertainties of 1919 were over. There seemed little doubt about what was going to happen. America was going on the greatest, gaudiest spree in history, and there was going to be plenty to tell about it. F. Scott Fitzgerald, 1937. Introduction. Clio and Scott. I feel that Scott's greatest contribution was the dramatization of a heartbroken era. Zelda Fitzgerald, 1947. Scott Fitzgerald once wrote, "There never was a good biography of a good novelist. There couldn't be. He is too many people if he's any good." Despite this peremptory warning, several important Fitzgerald biographies have appeared over the years. Most have emphasized some particular aspect of the man, be it his personality, writings, relationships with women, or battles with the bottle. Each of these studies has benefited from a surplus of primary source material. Fitzgerald was a meticulous self-chronicler, leaving behind a large cache of notes, hundreds of letters, a detailed ledger, and several autobiographical essays. His admonitions notwithstanding, one might fairly argue for his role as a recurrent collaborator with the Brotherhood of Biographers. He wished to be understood on his own terms, principally as an artist immersed in his times, sensitive to change, and writing for the ages. As a point of departure, that is the premise behind this book. Within a larger life and work narrative, I treat Fitzgerald as a cultural historian, the analyst as novelist who recorded the wildly fluctuating fortunes of America in the boom 20s and bust 30s. Equal parts author, observer, and participant, he supposed himself uniquely capable of probing below the surface of his society. "I really believe," he once put the matter to literary critic Edmund Wilson, his old Princeton classmate and an important influence, "that no one else could have written so searchingly the story of the youth of our generation." Certainly, he captured its mood, aspirations, and uncertainties more evocatively than did any writer commenting on the era's strange mingling of ebullience and insecurity, this transformative period pinched between the destabling powers of two world wars. My own training as a historian has shaped how I read Fitzgerald and offers, I trust, a few fresh insights into a much-discussed life. To grasp Fitzgerald's concern in The Great Gatsby, for example, that the romantic pioneer promise of America no longer inspired its people, is to more broadly recognize his sharp reaction to the death of Victorian idealism that followed the Great War. In this respect, I see Fitzgerald less as a mere and familiar commentator on Gatsby's Jazz Age Manhattan than as a national and even an international interpreter in the company of such contemporaries as Gertrude Stein, John Maynard Keynes, and Pablo Picasso. Alike, they struggled to make sense of the first unsettled decades of the new century, a particularly violent epoch marked by the collapse of several European empires, a severe global economic downturn, and a fierce ideological struggle between democracy, communism, and fascism. It is this linking of the man and his much-mythologized times that I emphasize in this book. Like most historians, Fitzgerald approached the past with a point of view. Though pigeonholed in popular memory as a Jazz Age Epicurean, he was at heart a moralist, struck by the sudden cultural shift in mood and manners that trailed the ill-fated Treaty of Versailles. As he stressed to his daughter, Scotty, in 1938, "My generation of radicals and breakers down never found anything to take the place of the old virtues of work and courage and the old graces of courtesy and politeness." Deeply suspicious of money's stunning power in industrial America, Fitzgerald possessed a historical sensibility that leaned toward the aristocratic, the pre-modern, and the romantic. In a youth touched by financial uncertainty, he liked to imagine himself the foundling child of a courageous king. A hungry reader of history, his taste in biography ran to the great man school of Caesar and Napoleon. Money, the inevitable fins and wings of a restless modern West, meant little to Fitzgerald except as a long-standing source of resentment. "I have never been able to forgive the rich for being rich," he once confessed, "and it has colored my entire life and works." With America's landed gentry passing from the scene, Fitzgerald's literary imagination was drawn to the new urban set, the bonds traders and the bootleggers, the Freudians and the flappers, suddenly in saddle. More than agents of affluence, these archetypes of the Roaring Twenties now set the cultural tone and tempo, seizing from small-town America the socializing power to shape a civilization. As a popular short story writer, Fitzgerald enjoyed access to the new money, and it gave him a vantage of cultural insight that would have been otherwise closed. Still, he never thought of himself, even during his peak earning years, as being part of the nouveau riche. His deepest allegiances, rather, were to that rapidly fading complex of courtly antebellum beliefs that he connected with his father's fashionable Chesapeake Bay roots. More specifically, as a Midwesterner, as an Irish Catholic, and despite a steady stream of royalties and advances, as a perpetually in-debt author, he felt every bit the social and economic outsider in the haute bourgeoisie haunts, Lake Forest, Princeton, and certain Hollywood enclaves, that had such a prevailing impact on his work. Wilson hit the mark when saying of Fitzgerald, "He casts himself in the role of the playboy, yet at the playboy he incessantly mocks." Fitzgerald's historical awareness was at its core sentimental, nostalgic, and conservative. He never lost his boyish enthusiasm for the valor of Civil War generals or collegiate football heroes, nor did he doubt that the coming world of large-scale bureaucratic structures, whether in the guise of rising capitalist corporations or powerful trade unions, would injure the cause of individual freedom, glory, and ambition. In his everyday life, Fitzgerald held, as this book explores, rather conventional to ultra-conventional views on sex, marriage, and child-rearing. His choice in homes reflected further a taste for playing the country squire that time forgot. From 1927 to 1929, the Fitzgeralds leased Ellerslie, a ducal 1842 Greek Revival mansion situated alongside the Delaware River just outside of Wilmington. In the early 1930s, they moved to La Paix, a rambling Victorian in a wooded area north of Baltimore, where Scott completed what some people believe to be his best book, Tender is the Night. He thought of this last address as a return home of sorts. Though Minnesota-born, he descended on his father's side from several pre-revolutionary Maryland families. Armed with a patriotic pedigree, he claimed a distant connection to Francis Scott Key, Fitzgerald saw himself as something of an authentic aristocrat put out to pasture by the pocketbook power of wealthy arrivistes. "I believe he'd have lived a completely happy life and died a happy death," his good friend John Biggs Jr. told a reporter in the 1970s, "as an Irish landed gentleman of the 17th century." The solidity of place and station to which Fitzgerald aspired no doubt reflected the ongoing uncertainties of his situation. Put simply, Scott uprooted easily. In some sense, the pretensions of an established Maryland lineage cushioned the reality that he remained throughout his life a restless and somewhat transitory figure. Before the age of 13, he had lived in St. Paul, twice, Syracuse, and Buffalo, twice. When he was an adult, this itinerant pattern continued, Move followed move on both sides of the Atlantic. New York gave way to Paris, Paris to Provence, Provence to... Perhaps he needed the landed gentleman facade to give him a sense of home groundedness that would lend his writing its unusually assured voice, flair, and perspective. Or, stated slightly differently, perhaps the Maryland strain, both real and magnified, furnished Fitzgerald with a distinct angle of vision. On a far more private level, however, beyond the reflected glory of a gilded family tree, Fitzgerald saw himself as a fundamentally weak man. His penchant for hero worship, from football players to film producers, can undoubtedly be traced back to seeking in others those particular qualities of self-discipline and self-assurance that he so conspicuously lacked. Fitzgerald worried about his height, his sexuality, and his physical courage on the athletic field. He grew defensive over his drinking and debts and the nearly decade-long pause between the publication of The Great Gatsby and its successor, Tender as the Night. He wanted to be the whole man, but knew that required a certain emotional sobriety beyond his ken. His, we know from countless reports, was a life of drama and self-destruction. High living and reckless spending, wounding marital battles, and the occasional brawls with bouncers and cabbies form a large part of the eternal Fitzgerald narrative. If Fitzgerald was anxious and erratic in his private life, he took on a more confident public persona. With the success of his first novel, This Side of Paradise, the then 23-year-old writer suddenly became an authority on, as one reviewer grandly put it, the intellectual and moral reaction that is set in among the more advanced American circles. From the moment he gained a sizable audience, in other words, Fitzgerald was being read as an authoritative cultural commentator. Indeed, Paradise doubled as a social history of the times, and a great many readers, not just those in the more advanced circles, thumbed through its pages in search of clues, observations, and advice on the new world that was coming or had already arrived. More particularly, Paradise touched on the social permissiveness of the era, increasingly candid attitudes toward sexuality, and the general coming down of pre-war cultural taboos. As the suddenly anointed interpreter of American youth, Fitzgerald was expected to be an expert on such matters as prohibition-defying drinking, petting parties, and the bacchanalian side of the collegiate circuit. In this way, very early in his career, and not for the better, did the line separating his personal and public lives blur. Many readers undoubtedly wanted to believe that he lived his books, and the popular press only encouraged this fantasy. No wonder that he once wrote with some frustration to Max Perkins, his editor at Scribner, "I'm tired of being the author of This Side of Paradise, and I want to start over." In a very meaningful way, he never did. For despite the reputation of Paradise as a book for the young or the young at heart, it proved to be a template for Fitzgerald's mature works. Whether in the jazz age 20s or the depression 30s, his best novels, short stories, and essays seem to be of multiple moments, recording both the immediate and the more distant rhythms of capital accumulation, immigration, and sexual politics that were moving America further away from its Protestant agrarian moorings. Today, in a new century, we continue to find his handling of these themes absorbing. The shiny surfaces of his writings, the pitch-perfect cadences, the knowing eye for contemporary color, and the discerning ear for current dialogue are put in the service of a deeper and seemingly timeless historical vision. Fitzgerald's penetrating descriptions of the Western world's leap from feudalism to capitalism, from faith to secularism, and from the tradition-oriented to the flux-oriented make him one of the more important cultural commentators America has produced. His truest intellectual contemporaries include the historian Henry Adams and the German historian-philosopher Oswald Spengler, both of whom are treated in this study. They, along with Fitzgerald, belong to what we might call the decline school of historical thought. All three doubted whether older pre-Enlightenment notions of art, creativity, paternalism, and worship would survive the onset of what we have since come to call modernity. In a sense, we have always understood Fitzgerald to be a student of the past who took up as his special expertise the Jeffersonian pursuit of happiness hypothesis, known today as the American Dream. For today's readers, the dream might signify a private temporal triumph, a good job, a well-furnished home, and a comfortable retirement. To Fitzgerald, however, the promise of America meant something much different. Like the founders, he saw America as a continent of possibilities, a place to escape the old world's rigidly enforced class structures and adopt new identities. Put another way, his emphasis was not on the accumulating, but rather on the becoming. He wrote in one short story that the best of America was the best of the world, and he identified a distinctive willingness of the heart, an unquestioning commitment to human freedom, as the special something that had once made Americans a unique, even transcendent people. Fitzgerald thought of these virtues as having largely expired in the decades following the Civil War, as the new era, the Gilded Age, underwrote the rise of vast industrial fortunes that blotted out an earlier idealism with a dynamic, if, by comparison, soulless materialism. That is why his heroes tend to be tragic figures, romantics destroyed in the end by bureaucrats and baby vamps, by the idle rich and by fate itself. Disillusioned with a society that offered little more than avenues to make money, their heroic sensibilities were invariably blocked and blunted. Time and again, Fitzgerald relentlessly raised the question from which he himself could not rest. If America was founded on a towering, if fragile, dream, then what would come to pass when all the dreamers were gone? Most books can point to a pedigree, and this one is no exception. Fitzgerald's remarkably sensitive historical imagination has long stirred interest among a subset of scholars, even as his popular reputation remained firmly tied to the 1920s. His contemporary, the influential literary critic Malcolm Cowley, got Scott right, I think, when he observed, "Fitzgerald never lost a quality that very few writers are able to acquire, a sense of living in history. Manners and morals were changing all through his life, and he set himself the task of recording the changes." Eager to tease out meaning from the everyday, Fitzgerald utilized a kind of page-by-page cultural saturation strategy. His books and stories, essays and articles are filled with newsmakers, athletes and entertainers, as well as popular films, music and books. His reflective 1931 essay, Echoes of the Jazz Age, is scaffolded by the May Day riots of 1919, the Sacco and Vanzetti case, the Leopold and Loeb trial, Charles Lindbergh, Clara Bow, and Warren G. Harding, all of it textbook material to this day. The following year, his elegiac My Lost City, written of New York in the High Depression summer of 1932, inventoried the fast-fading world of Jazz Age Manhattan, including references to various period-piece hotels, eateries, and bars. Bostanobi's Café de la Paix, the Club de Vingt on East 58th Street, and the cool Japanese gardens of the Ritz. Far from an exercise in nostalgia, however, the essay strives for a broader and more telling point. It closes with Fitzgerald standing on the observation deck of the recently erected Empire State Building, dismayed by the sudden awareness of the central meaning of the 1920s, that the city, the nation, and the economy without limits had limits. Not for the first time did he link perspective with penance. Cowley's appreciation of Fitzgerald's historical sensibility anticipated scores of studies essaying this important theme, and many of them inform my own work. They very often, and understandably, focus their analyses on Fitzgerald's most celebrated books, The Great Gatsby and Tender is the Night. An example of the former is Richard Leon's thoughtful 1995 monograph, The Great Gatsby, The Limits of Wonder. Leon persuasively argues that Gatsby cannot be properly appraised without taking into account the Western world's erratic course following the Franco-Prussian War. That conflict unified Germany and prefaced the European alliance system that led disastrously to the continent's collapse in 1914. On a somewhat smaller scale, Leon looks closely at the 1920s, a decade of deep and irreversible changes in America. Immigration from Southern and Eastern Europe contrasted with traditional Northern European settlement. Socialists questioned the country's capitalist orientation, and the 1920 census reported that for the first time, there were more Americans living in cities than in the countryside. Scott recognized all of this, and Leon rightly concludes that to grasp the fundamental ideas and insecurities underpinning The Great Gatsby, readers must, like its author, have a working sense of the past. That resolve holds equally true for Gatsby's follow-up, Tender is the Night. In an illuminating 1994 study of that novel, Milton R. Stern emphasizes how the Great War made Scott aware of the total cultural exhaustion of the Victorian world of his parents. In Stern's reading, Fitzgerald mistrusted the relaxed moral restraints and stock market materialism of the 20s that had eroded a once ascendant strain of romantic idealism. Completed in the depths of the Great Depression amid the rising tide of fascism, Tender shoulders the weight of its author's concerns that contemporary culture, politics, and economics were running at best to questionable ends. What then was the point of urban industrial America? Would liberal democracies survive the decade? And how could the old ways be reconciled with the new? More than anything Fitzgerald wrote, Tender wrestles with the perils of America's stumbling march to modernity, prompting Stern to call it the American historical novel. Apart from these types of large appraisals of Fitzgerald, in which he is read as something of a post-Victorian prophet, scholars have also been interested in smaller assessments evaluating his relationship to the interwar period. The Cambridge Companion to F. Scott Fitzgerald, edited by Ruth Pregosi, and the Kirk Kernut edited volume, A Historical Guide to F. Scott Fitzgerald, offers several fine essays that take up this task. These include studies on the post-war consumer and intellectual environment, the impact of flappers and flapper films on Fitzgerald's writing, and his relationship to the American publishing industry. Collectively, the articles make the case for an interdisciplinary approach to Fitzgerald and his works, one sensitive to the milieu in which he lived and wrote. Tellingly, the Kernut book includes an illustrated chronology pairing Fitzgerald's life with a proportionate list of historical events, the Armory Show, the Paris Peace Conference, Lindbergh's transatlantic flight, that shaped his days. A more recent collection that reads Fitzgerald through his times and vice versa is Bryant Mangum's edited work F. Scott Fitzgerald in Context. Indeed, the book's attention to historical setting is such that both Fitzgerald students and those more generally interested in the cultural development of America in the 1920s and 30s will find it indispensable. Its wide-ranging exploration of more than three dozen topics, including nuanced looks at class, ethnicity, fashion, and architecture, marks it as the most comprehensive source of its kind and certainly the latest word on Fitzgerald's studies. Perhaps the work with which mine aligns most closely is Robert Sklar's pioneering survey, F. Scott Fitzgerald, The Last Laocoon. I largely agree with Sklar's contention that Fitzgerald's deepest loyalties were to the genteel romantic ideals that pervaded late 19th century American culture. These include once firmly rooted conceptions of chivalry and honor, deference and paternalism. Invoking Virgil's Aeneid, Sklar compares Fitzgerald to Laocoon, a priest of Apollo who thrust his spear into the wooden horse to warn his Trojan countrymen against Greek treachery. The Trojans failed to heed him. Then two serpents at Athena's call came up from the sea and destroyed him with his sons. Cautioning readers that the loss of traditional moral codes would harm them, Scott, like Laocoon, was ignored and, in terms of declining book sales royalties, killed, so Sklar contends. I believe, in broad terms, this to be a provocative and defendable argument. Where the present study diverges from Sklar's work is less in its conclusions than in its biographical approach. What I find lacking in Laocoon is any substantial discussion of the personal dynamics that formed Fitzgerald's thinking on the urban industrial process. His mother, Molly McQuillan, and his father, Edward Fitzgerald, were, I think, critical in this regard. Though they embodied for Fitzgerald distinct sides of the American experience, the rising immigrant in Molly's case, the vanishing Southern aristocracy in Edward's, they shared a marital life burdened by an inexorable slide into polite poverty. This left an indelible mark on Scott. Attracted to his ineffectual father's courtly, if historically spent, outlook, he evinced early and for the rest of his life a genuine compassion for those who were plowed under by progress. Certainly the doomed heroes of his novels fit this problematic profile. Thus, his relationship to what Sklar calls the Apollonian virtues must, I think, be understood within the context of provincial St. Paul and the ancestral Fitzgeralds in Francis Scott Key's Maryland. Together, Fitzgerald's parents merit but a single citation in Sklar's study, and the Chesapeake Civil War angle is, considering its vital importance to Fitzgerald's sense of past, underplayed. I believe that Fitzgerald was able to write as powerfully as he did about historical change in America because he identified with it in such a personal way. He knew that his great-grandmother once visited Dolly Madison, and that was important to him. A second distinction between this study and Sklar's is worth noting. Whereas Laocoon traces Fitzgerald to an older tradition of American writers preoccupied with shifting Western beliefs and values, Cooper, Hawthorne, Melville, and James, I see him as far more intellectually in tune with his times and strongly influenced by social critics and historians as well as literary writers. Specifically, he interpreted the Great American Boom in ways that overlapped with contemporaries Charles Beard and Thorstein Veblen. In ruminating on the meaning of a frontierless America, he echoed the concerns of Frederick Jackson Turner. And in writing on the travails of youth, he can be read profitably alongside Randolph Bourne. That two of these writers were among the most influential historians of the 20th century should not surprise us. The past never ceased speaking to Scott. My biography of Fitzgerald is composed of four parts. The first, Beginnings, explores Fitzgerald's early life from birth to his marriage in 1920 to the Alabama belle Zelda Sayre. It surveys first loves, writings, and influences, while detailing family history and the set of social, economic, and psychological factors that merge to create in Fitzgerald a complex and oversensitive personality. Money, or the lack of it, always teased him. His maternal grandfather had made a small fortune in the wholesale grocery business, and that kept two succeeding generations lingering on the outer edge of well-bred St. Paul, Minnesota society. Feeling, as he put it late in life, like a poor boy in a rich town, a poor boy in a rich boy's school, Fitzgerald recognized in his precarious prep boy status the sharp insecurities that one day underlay Jay Gatsby's tenuous claim to Daisy Fay. Part 2, Building Up, essays Fitzgerald's early novels and short stories within the context of both his personal circumstances and the broader dimensions of American life. These were, in many respects, triumphant years for Fitzgerald. He forged what proved to be a long-standing relationship with the distinguished House of Scribner. He began making real money by selling his short stories to the Saturday Evening Post, and he became a father. His life would never look so promising as it did in 1925 with the publication of The Great Gatsby, a remarkable artistic leap beyond his first two books. In later years, he often glanced back on this golden period as the culmination of an early success that had brought him to the summit of American letters. Part 3, Breaking Down, the book's longest section, examines the many difficulties that began to close in on Fitzgerald. These were years of increasing alcohol abuse and declining financial fortunes, which coincide with Zelda's institutionalization for what her physicians diagnosed as schizophrenia. Much of this period overlapped the Great Depression, and Fitzgerald, once the embodiment of 20s excess, now styled himself in his writings as a case of 30s contrition. He embellished on these unsettling emotions in his 1934 novel Tender as the Night. His favorite among his own books, Tender, analyzed within the narrative framework of a dying marriage, the collapse of an old Victorian universe, and its replacement by a brave new world dominated by hardened survivors who had managed to pass through the carnage of the Great War seemingly without regret or reflection. They inherited, Fitzgerald argued, a diminished social order bereft of compassion, sentimentality, or even the comforting consistency of, as he put it, middle-class love. This section closes with chapters on Fitzgerald's Hollywood years, the final years of his life. As a screenwriter, he managed some semblance of financial responsibility, found a new golden girl, the syndicated gossip columnist Sheila Graham, and was deep into a fresh novel at the time of his death, the posthumously published The Last Tycoon. Despite such compensations, this late-in-the-game Hollywood turn brought Fitzgerald little peace. A part of him saw these years as a dull aftermath, as a kind of atonement for the high, hard living of the past. The fact that he never liked living in California and found it impossible to mute his deeply ingrained aversion to the business-first mentality of the studio bosses further contributed to his sense of alienation on the West Coast. Part 4, Ghosts and Legends, looks briefly at Zelda's life after Scott and the unexpected rise of the Fitzgerald legend. All but forgotten at the time of his death, Fitzgerald received in his last royalty check a double unlucky $13.13. And yet, within a few years, this all but forgotten oracle of the 1920s found in his afterlife new fame as the interpreter of the American dream. Even those who were closest to him were amazed at Fitzgerald's growing reputation and the devotion of many of his readers. As Wilson remembered, "I had to recognize that my gifted but all too human old friend had been cast in the role of Attis Adonis, the fair youth, untimely slain, who is ritually bewailed by women, then resuscitates, as Fitzgerald did, after perishing in the decline of his reputation, when his books were republished and more seriously read than they had usually been during his lifetime, and when his legend became full-fledged and beyond his own power to shatter it." Of course, that legend remains indestructible in our own time, a testimony to the enduring fascination readers have with Fitzgerald's life and books. This biography examines both, reading his relationships and writings alike within the context of the cultural revolution that marked the transition from the genteel world of morality to the modern world of mobility. The latter promised, through the miracle of mass production, a coming age of endless purchases and personal choices. Yet Fitzgerald believed that something profound in the human experience had perished along the way. Expected to be happy, productive, and successful, many of the privileged Americans he wrote about were burdened by the advantages of their abundance and unable to develop mature perspectives. As he stated the problem to Scotty, "Once one is caught up into the material world, not one person in 10,000 finds time to form what, for lack of a better phrase, I might call the wise and tragic sense of life. By this I mean the sense that life is essentially a cheat and its conditions are those of defeat." More generally, however, Fitzgerald, for all his wise words on the tragic sense of life, remained a willing captive to the romantic optimism that shadowed so much of his early work. Even when dogged by a host of personal demons, he never gave up on America, never lost his appreciation for a country that, for all its adventures in post-war escapism, represented, as he once affectionately put it, the warm center of the world. Neither a skeptic nor a cynic, he struggled until the end of his life to recognize the waning 19th-century conventions of his father's generation and to call into question the self-congratulatory spending at the heart of 20th-century America's rising republic of consumers. It is the tension between these two positions and Fitzgerald's desire to somehow sustain the former and to regain this paradise lost that bring an unusual power, introspection, and pathos to his writing. Part 1. Beginnings, 1896 to 1920. "When I was your age, I lived with a great dream. The dream grew, and I learned how to speak of it and make people listen." F. Scott Fitzgerald to Scotty Fitzgerald, age 16, 1938. 1. Prince and Pauper. "I've been thinking about my father again, and it makes me sad like the past always does." F. Scott Fitzgerald, 1931. In the spring of 1934, John Jameson, a Pittsburgher, wrote to Scott Fitzgerald asking him about the origins of his most iconic character, the great Jay Gatsby. In a lettered reply, Fitzgerald explained, "He was perhaps created on the image of some forgotten farm type of Minnesota that I have known and forgotten and associated at the same moment with some sense of romance." Gatsby's origins have long occasioned debate among literary detectives. In company with Fitzgerald's forgotten farm type, some have recognized in Gatsby the echoes of John Keats's disillusioned lovers, Henry Adams's mythical medieval virgin, or Oswald Spengler's anachronistic Apollonian man, bearer of reason and harmony in an increasingly inharmonious world. In common, did these writers confront the modern West's transition from a civilization based on hierarchy, tradition, and cultural unity to one increasingly fragmented in the push-pull of the emergent urban-industrial process. They memorialized, in other words, a dying spirit of romantic expression. Among these types, one might too include the industrious Philip Francis McQuillan, a romantic in his own right. Fitzgerald's maternal grandfather and resident model of the self-made man rising in America, McQuillan emigrated at the age of 8 from County Fermanagh, Ireland, in 1842, settling with his parents and 6 siblings in Galena, a small Upper Illinois town near the Mississippi River. The hamlet became for Fitzgerald an idealized place of possibilities, the embodiment of, as he put it in Gatsby, a fresh green breast of the new world that once drew Dutch sailors over Atlantic squalls and now called their ancestral sons across a continent. In his 1934 novel, Tender is the Night, Fitzgerald described a young and then obscure Ulysses S. Grant lolling in his general store in Galena ready to be called to an intricate destiny. And when fate came knocking in 1861, Grant grew into himself. Rising in rank from colonel of the 21st Illinois Volunteer Infantry Regiment to commander of all Union armies, he led the military charge against the slaveholders' rebellion, claiming key victories at Shiloh and Vicksburg in the war's Western Theater before bleeding Robert E. Lee's celebrated Army of Northern Virginia and overseeing its surrender at Appomattox Courthouse in the early spring of 1865. From there, his star kept ascending, and Grant served two terms as president. After his death in 1885 at the age of 63, he was interred at the General Grant National Memorial, colloquially known as Grant's Tomb, which to this day remains the largest mausoleum in North America. For Scott, Grant's success was a quintessentially American story, literally the stuff that dreams were made of. Like Grant and Gatsby, McQuillan discovered in the erratic mobility of America an inexhaustible arena for reinvention. In 1857, he moved to St. Paul, capital city of the Minnesota Territory, and found work as a bookkeeper for Beaupré and Temple, a major wholesale grocery establishment. At 38, he took over the business and soon amassed a fortune. Along the way, McQuillan married Louisa Allen of Galena, and they had eight children, five of whom lived beyond infancy. Like Fitzgerald's, McQuillan's life was marked by a brilliant early success, followed by an early exit. Suffering from chronic nephritis compounded by tuberculosis, he died in April 1877, just 1 week after turning 43. He left behind a considerable legacy of some $270,000, a relative value today of about $6 million. From immigrant poverty to industrial age prosperity, McQuillan corporealized for many Minnesotans the material side of the American dream. One obituary called his life a living romance, for in the brief period of 20 years, he passed, by his own unaided exertions, from the humblest beginnings to a place among the merchant princes of the country. Another St. Paul paper evoked the rising people theme, celebrated in both Benjamin Franklin's iconic autobiography and Horatio Alger's formulaic Luck and Pluck tales, when reviewing McQuillan's splendid ascent. He came here a poor boy with but a few dollars in his pocket, depending solely on a clear head, sound judgment, good habits, strict honesty and willing hands, with strict integrity his guiding motive. How these qualities have aided him is shown in the immense business he has built up, the acquisition of large property outside, and the universal respect felt for him by the businessmen of the country, among whom probably no man was better known or stood higher. But if McQuillan's commercial kingdom symbolized local capitalist success, it further, and less agreeably, suggested the inevitable eclipse of an older pastoral idea. One broadsheet described Philip Francis as a pioneer of wholesale grocery, a tribute that blurred the lines between backwoodsman and businessman, and thus traded on the public's affection for a fading frontier archetype. Amid a booming urban industrial backdrop, Americans looked nostalgically on the last open lands as their final link to the old democracy, mobility, and independence. It was this sentiment that informed Frederick Jackson Turner's famous frontier thesis, and later coaxed Henry Ford to create, in the Detroit suburb of Dearborn, Greenfield Village, a shrine of sorts to the passing age of 19th-century American individualism. Filled with workshops, farmhouses, and mills, it embodies to this day the spirit of the old horse-and-buggy Middle West that Ford's automobile empire had ironically done so much to obliterate. McQuillan's surviving children enjoyed all the material, cultural, and educational accoutrement that their affluent father could provide. The family occupied a multi-story Victorian in the heart of St. Paul and generously patronized the city's many Catholic appendages. In the words of one appreciative resident archbishop, none have merited more of the church in the city. Mary, Molly, McQuillan, Philip Francis's eldest daughter and Fitzgerald's mother, was born in 1860 and bred to expectations of upper-middle-class respectability. She attended Manhattanville College of the Sacred Heart, a Catholic boarding school for girls then located in New York City, and made several trips to Europe. The governor of Minnesota attended her wedding reception. A distracted, dowdy woman inclined to eccentricities, Molly McQuillan gave the impression of wanting far more from life than life was willing to give her. Contemporaries, put off by her sometimes mismatched shoes, a habit of breaking one in at a time, unkempt hair and habitual umbrella, referred to her unkindly as a witch. One of Scott's schoolteachers remembered her dressed like the devil, always coming apart. Her tendency to innocently unleash the oddly inappropriate comment, "I'm trying to decide how you'll look in mourning," she once let slip to the wife of a dying man, fueled the casual hostility of the people around her. As one St. Paulian put it, Molly was a pathetic, wispy little woman. People were cruel to her, and Scott was ashamed of her. This embarrassment can be read in the opening line of Fitzgerald's 1936 story, An Author's Mother. She was a halting old lady in a black silk dress and a rather preposterously high-crowned hat that some milliner had foisted upon her declining sight. Nearing a then spinsterish 30 in 1890, Molly married Edward Fitzgerald, a man whom she had known for several years and who was several years her senior. Scotty Fitzgerald later recounted for a biographer the family gossip regarding their supposedly one-sided courtship. Daddy said that his father had told him that he was sitting in the parlor one night with Molly and talking about this and that when she called her parents in and announced how wonderful it was that she was engaged to marry Ed, and that he had been too much a gentleman to know how to get out of it. Scotty knew in relating this story that Molly's father had died several years before his daughter's marriage, but she passed it on nevertheless, as she believed, even with the particulars in question, that it must have had more than a germ of truth. In any case, the Fitzgerald-McQuillan marriage did not produce a meeting of minds, hearts, or bank accounts. Decamping on a European honeymoon, the little-traveled Edward eagerly awaited the Champs-Élysées and requested Molly's company for a first-day stroll. Her tactless rejoinder, "But I've already seen Paris," anticipated decades of marital disconnects. Though Edward shared Molly's Irish Catholicism, he brought to their alliance a decidedly different range of references. A Southerner born near Rockville, Maryland in 1853, he was weaned on memories of the Confederate lost cause and seemed ill-suited to the land of Yankee capitalism, to which, first in Chicago and subsequently in St. Paul, the post-war boom brought him. His maternal roots, the Scott side, ran deep into the American past and gave him a vicarious glory that no amount of McQuillan money could buy. Scott Fitzgerald picked up on these ancestral cues and sported with Philip Francis's grubby merchant roots in his first novel, This Side of Paradise. In it, a hitherto admired Princetonian stock drops after a classmate reveals an ugly secret. If you want to know the shocking truth, his father was a grocery clerk. The Fitzgeralds, by contrast, could point proudly to generations of civic service in colonial legislatures and governors' assemblies. The most famous branch of the family tree led to Francis Scott Key, the author of The Star-Spangled Banner, and brother to Edward's great-great-grandfather. And, adding notoriety, the ill-fated Mary Surratt, convicted and hanged in the summer of 1865 for taking part in the conspiracy to assassinate Abraham Lincoln, was mother-in-law to Edward's first cousin. Edward himself could claim a personal rendezvous with American history, which, if not on the inflated order of Grant, was still worth the making of several stirring bedtime stories. Though border state Maryland remained in the Union, its loyalties were divided. The southern and eastern parts of the state were tied to a tobacco and slavery economy and favored joining the new Confederate government. The northern and western areas were typically pro-Union. In the 1860 presidential election, Maryland had given its 8 electoral votes to Kentucky's John C. Breckinridge, the candidate of the Southern Democratic coalition that had formed that summer and split the Democratic Party in half. Lincoln, by contrast, carried less than 3% of the state's popular vote. An alleged February 1861 plot to assassinate the president-elect in Baltimore forced Lincoln to take the precautionary measure of traveling through the city unannounced in the dead of night. Critics called him a coward. 3 months later, 1,000 federal soldiers under General Benjamin F. Butler occupied Federal Hill overlooking Baltimore and arrested the city's mayor and police commissioner. Martial law was declared, and by that summer, Union power was asserted throughout the state. Edward's adolescent sympathies, along with much of the Rockville-Montgomery County area, were with the South. At the age of 9, in the first full year of the Civil War, he had rowed Confederate spies across the Potomac. He subsequently helped a member of Mosby's Raiders, the famed 43rd Battalion, 1st Virginia Cavalry, led by John Singleton Mosby, avoid arrest. And he cheered on Jubal Early's army as it drove off Union forces at the Battle of Monocacy, just outside of Frederick, and proceeded to march on nearby Washington before meeting stiff resistance at Fort Stevens and retreating. In weighing this paternal impact, Scott Fitzgerald was later to write, "So many legends of my family went west with father." Courtly, deferential, and distinguished by a neatly sculpted Van Dyke beard, Edward fairly trailed clouds of faded Southern glory. A cultural conservative indifferent to the businessman's perspective, he had chivalric manners that were conspicuously dated in the dawning age of machines. Marriage to Molly inspired no Philip Francis-like success on his part. If anything, Edward seemed silently, stubbornly proud of his inability to make money. Faintly indolent and temperamentally unsuited for St. Paul's bustle and vigor, he tried his luck in upstate New York before finally falling into a permanent occupational paralysis. Eventually given a sinecure by the McQuillans, an office with no duties, he came to resent his in-laws. Humiliated, he chalked up his penury to a superior aristocratic sensibility. In June 1896, the Fitzgeralds cruelly lost their 2 young daughters, Mary and Louise, to an epidemic. Heartbroken, Edward wrote to his mother, "I wonder sometimes if I will ever have any interest in life again. Perhaps so, but certainly the keen zest of enjoyment is gone forever." 3 months later, on 24 September, his son, Francis Scott Fitzgerald, was born. The deaths, though never brought up, seemed in some firm, if incommunicable, way to set in motion the new child's intricate destiny. Certain suggestions, feelings, and intangibles were conveyed in Molly's pain. "Shortly before I was born," Fitzgerald later recalled, "my mother lost her other 2 children, and I think that came first of all, though I don't know how it worked exactly. I think I started then to be a writer." As if to compensate for both the deaths of Mary and Louise and the embarrassment of Edward's inertia, Molly lavished a mother's love on her son. Much to Fitzgerald's mortification, she spoiled him so obviously as to be the source of his first youthful shame. Writing from Camp Chatham at Orillia, Ontario, in the summer of 1907, He tried, with the fumbling tact of a 10-year-old, to dissuade her unwanted visit. "Dear Mother, I received your letter this morning, and though I would like very much to have you up here, I don't think you would like it, as you know no one here except Mrs. Upton, and she is busy most of the time. I don't think you would like the accommodations, as it is only a small town and no good hotels. There are some very nice boarding houses, but about the only fare is lamb and beef." By late adolescence, Fitzgerald had come to see Molly's persistent petting as the cause of both his sensitive bearing and insecurity-driven snobbishness. In reaction, he idolized football players, war heroes, and business titans, men presumably able to overcome the nursery caresses doled out by doting mothers, or the thin legacy of idle fathers. In later life, Scott blamed Molly for his brittle ego. "So you see, I looked at myself in two ways. There seemed to have been a conspiracy to spoil me, and all my inordinate vanity was absorbed from that. All this was on the surface, however, and liable to be toppled over at one blow by an unpleasant remark or a missed tackle, and underneath it came my own sense of lack of courage and stability." Scott's distance from Molly lingers about this side of paradise. The spirited Beatrice Blaine, Amory Blaine's mother, seems the parentis maximus of Scott's dreams. Sophisticated, educated, and privileged, she is everything that Molly was not. Her youth passed in Renaissance glory. Her small talk was broadened during a winter in Vienna. Without Molly, Fitzgerald supposed, he would have been emotionally stronger and better equipped to deal with adversity. He blamed her for lowering his horizons and limiting his opportunities. "Mother and I never had anything in common except a relentless, stubborn quality," he once told his sister Annabelle. She embarrassed him, she didn't understand him, and she never encouraged his writing. In what seems a lightly veiled maternal reference, he wrote in one story, "The books by her son were not vivid to her, and while she was proud of him in a way, and was always glad when a librarian mentioned him, or when someone asked her if she was his mother, her secret opinion was that such a profession was risky and eccentric." In 1931, the year Edward died, Scott Fitzgerald transcribed a dream that he believed got to the root of his resentments. "I am in an upstairs apartment where I live with my mother, old, white-haired, clumsy, and in mourning, as she is today. On another floor are a group of handsome and rich young men, whom I seem to have known slightly as a child and now want to know better, but they look at me suspiciously. I talk to one who is agreeable and not at all snobbish, but obviously he does not encourage my acquaintance, whether because he considers me poor, unimportant, ill-bred, or of ill renown, I don't know, or rather don't think about, only I scent the polite indifference and even understand it." A quarrel with Molly ensues in the dream, born largely of Fitzgerald's refusal to be pitied for his tenuous social position. Hurt and frustrated, he arrives at the house of a stronger woman, his Aunt Annabelle, only to find that Molly has followed him there. Hungry, they both order bacon and eggs. Molly is served only bacon, Scott only eggs. Edward left his son with a different, if only slightly less difficult, mix of childhood memories. In search of work to supplement Molly's legacy, he moved the family in the spring of 1898 to Buffalo, where, hopelessly chasing Philip Francis's star, he took a position as a salesman with Procter & Gamble. A series of upstate transfers followed until, in March 1908, Edward lost his job at age 55. Scott learned of the blow via an overheard telephone conversation, and from that point on he considered his father, his favorite parent, irrelevant. That morning, Fitzgerald told a reporter years later, Edward had gone out a comparatively young man, a man full of strength, full of confidence. He came home that evening an old man, a completely broken man. He had lost his essential drive, his immaculateness of purpose. He was a failure the rest of his days. Embarrassed for Edward, and no doubt for himself, Fitzgerald conjured up an alternative backstory. "He once told me his father was an engineer for Jim Hill, the Western Railroad builder," remembered a college friend. "It was a lie." Failure or not, Edward still retained a firm hold on his son's heart. Offsetting Molly's overindulgence, he established for Scott expectations of conduct and consequences that nourished his moral imagination. Fitzgerald's adult recollection of a youthful indiscretion underlined the importance of this paternal influence. "I ran away when I was 7 on the 4th of July. I spent the day with a friend in a pear orchard, and the police were informed that I was missing. And on my return, my father thrashed me, according to the custom of the 90s, on the bottom, and then let me come out and watch the night fireworks from the balcony with my pants still down and my behind smarting, and knowing in my heart that he was absolutely right. Afterwards, seeing in his face his regret that it had to happen, I asked him to tell me a story." Perhaps as important as the occasional whipping, Edward offered Scott an alternative to McQuillan pretension. True, he had failed to secure a fortune, returning from work one day as a broken man, but this vice could be revisited as a real and positive virtue. Lacking the heart of a merchant or the taste for America's great post-Appomattox launch toward materialism, Edward paid tribute to his quasi-patrician roots by emphasizing ease over energy, benevolence over self-interest. In the ancestral contest between Fitzgerald romance and McQuillan verve, Scott's loyalties ran decidedly toward the former. Time and again, Edward's endangered principles appeared in his son's novels, carrying the moral weight of all good fathers everywhere. "In my younger and more vulnerable years," the great Gatsby begins, "my father gave me some advice that I've been turning over in my mind ever since. Whenever you feel like criticizing anyone," he told me, "just remember that all the people in this world haven't had the advantages that you've had." He didn't say any more, but we've always been unusually communicative in a reserved way, and I understand that he meant a great deal more than that. And again, in Tender is the Night, Fitzgerald created a father of aristocratic lineage who stands for an older ethical code. Dick loved his father. Again and again he referred judgments to what his father would probably have thought or done. Dick was born several months after the death of 2 young sisters, and his father, guessing what would be the effect on Dick's mother, had saved him from a spoiling by becoming his moral guide. He was of tired stock, yet he raised himself to that effort. The sea of settlers coming to Victorian St. Paul slackened by 1895, and in its aftermath the city adopted a civic identity fundamentally averse to neighboring Minneapolis. The former imagined itself a Catholic enclave of solid small banking and mercantile interests pitted against burgeoning Protestant speculative Minneapolis. St. Paul thus became, for Fitzgerald, the worldly embodiment of his father's values. It bowed, that is, before a more dynamic power, yet retained those genteel qualities of taste and grace that make life more than a scrum for money. St. Paul, Fitzgerald once explained, considered itself a little superior to the likes of Kansas City, Milwaukee, and Indianapolis, precisely because it was a 3-generation town. And this perspective opened for him a wide avenue of exploration into the American character and its relationship to place and tradition. Fitzgerald St. Paul suggested solidity and stability, a city of neighborhood hardware stores, spruced up main streets, and a few first families to establish tone. In a 1920 review, he selectively traced its history. In the 50s, the climate of St. Paul was reputed exceptionally healthy. Consequently, there arrived an element from the East who had both money and fashionable education. These Easterners mingled with the rising German and Irish stock, whose second generation left the cobbler's last, forgot the steerage, and became passionately swell on its own account. But the pace was set by the tubercular Easterners, hence the particular social complacency of St. Paul. The Atlantic urban centers, by contrast, with their speed and intensity, never quite seemed real to Fitzgerald. "Even when the East excited me most," he wrote in Gatsby, "even when I was most keenly aware of its superiority to the bored, sprawling, swollen towns beyond the Ohio, with their interminable inquisitions which spared only the children and the very old, even then it had always for me a quality of distortion." Perhaps this was so. Yet even St. Paul, with its merchant prince possibilities, teased Scott with dreams of grandeur. There, in reaction to assorted parental shortcomings, the itinerant years in upstate New York, and a wishful urgency for release, he imagined himself the foundling child of a Celtic king, like Grant in Galena, waiting in the wings for an imminent deliverance. Scott's gentry-sounding surname supported this fantasy. The Norman Fitz Filz is cognate to the Latin filius, son of. Thus, Fitzgerald means son of Gerald. When the suffix is roy, king, the meaning becomes son of the king. For centuries, the English and British royal families used Fitz in surnames, often in cases of illegitimacy. These nullius filius children include Matilda Fitzroy, Henry Fitzroy, and Lady Anne Palmer. Robert Fitzroy, a fourth-generation grandson of Charles II, captained the HMS Beagle during Darwin's famous voyage to the Galapagos Islands. In a retrospective 1936 story, Author's House, Fitzgerald seeks to explain the complicated dark mixture of his youth by recalling how he had desperately imagined for himself a different home, family, and life. Taking the reader through the imagined dwelling, he begins in the basement, leading a startled guest to a tomb in one of its corners. "That," he says, "is where I buried my first childish love of myself, my belief that I would never die like other people, and that I wasn't the son of my parents but a son of a king who ruled the whole world." But back in the real world, the McQuillan fortune, relatively rapid in its making, had begun to stubbornly ebb away. The Fitzgeralds were eager to maintain appearances, and their descent into genteel poverty resulted in years of nomadic wanderings around the city's fashionable Summit Avenue, brief homesteadings taken up and abandoned in the ongoing pursuit of ever more economical leases. The slide appeared to have little effect on Molly's social expectations. Despite dwindling resources, she anticipated that Scott and Annabelle would occupy a place among the local elite that was once so easily open to her and her siblings. This burden weighed on Scott, imparting a powerful poor boy among the rich boys resentment that fed his foundling fantasy. In September 1919, Scott wrote a letter to Alida Bigelow, a St. Paul friend then at Smith College. Scott had just completed his first novel but was unsure of its future, and he sounded every bit the frustrated prisoner of the Tower, complaining to Bigelow of his current plight. "In a house below the average, of a street above the average, in a room below the roof, with a lot above the ears." More fruitfully, Fitzgerald formed from the anxieties of adolescence a language and a literary mood that spoke observantly to a nation suddenly modern, yet inescapably nostalgic for those parts of itself now irretrievably gone. This sense of lost time came straight from the nursery. It bore the burdens of Edward's youthful Confederate sympathies, Molly's lost children, and the vanishing McQuillan wealth. The foundations of Fitzgerald's writings were laid, in other words, in the hauntedness of home. 2. Celtic Blood. There had been a time when his own Celtic traits were pillars of his personal philosophy. F. Scott Fitzgerald, This Side of Paradise, 1920. In the autumn of 1908, 12-year-old Scott Fitzgerald enrolled in St. Paul Academy, a private, non-sectarian school for boys one block north of the city's posh Summit Avenue. There, as a Catholic, as the son of an idle Southerner, and as a sojourner in a succession of houses below the average, he swam against the tide. Intelligent in a 12-going-on-16 kind of way, he compensated by overcompensating. At school, he talked too much, knew or pretended to know too much, and routinely condescended to his peers, who naturally delighted in shearing him down to size. If anybody can poison Scotty or stop his mouth in some way, one classmate pleaded in the student paper, the school at large and myself will be obliged. The cut stuck, and Fitzgerald repeated it nearly verbatim in his autobiographical 1928 short story, The Freshest Boy. If someone will please poison young Basil, or find some other means to stop his mouth, the school at large and myself will be much obliged. In Scott's case, the fresh boy was plainly father to the author. Despite suffering the occasional pang of unpopularity, Fitzgerald looked back on St. Paul Academy with some pride as the place where he first became a published author. His interest in detective novels inspired The Mystery of the Raymond Mortgage, a daffy whodunit appearing in the October 1909 edition of Now and Then, the student literary magazine. The tale of a missing document, Mystery contains a number of competent passages amid the occasional screamer. There is, after all, no Ithaca to Princeton train. Scott later remembered the excitement of seeing his debut in print. I read my story through at least 6 times, and all that day I loitered in the corridors and counted the number of men who were reading it, and tried to ask people casually if they had read it. Other stories followed. In Reed, Substitute Right Half, a physically slight second teamer carries his crew to an improbable gridiron victory. If the story instantiates a wish-fulfillment fantasy, Fitzgerald, a boastful but middling athlete relegated to his school football, basketball, and baseball reserve squads, reveals a deeper instinctual understanding that his best hope for recognition lay in literary achievement rather than athletic prowess. 2 additional stories rate mention. Both are Civil War sagas, evidence that Edwards, through a boy's eyes, remembrances of the rebellion touched his son deeply. A Debt of Honor follows a young Confederate sentry, pardoned by General Lee for falling asleep at his post, finding redemption in a heroic death at the Battle of Chancellorsville. This is the martial equivalent of Reed's special football exploits. In The Room with the Green Blinds, Fitzgerald wrote a historical fantasy of John Wilkes Booth surviving the Lincoln assassination hidden in a Gothic Georgian mansion, not for the last time with the ill-fated Mary Surratt and the shadowy rooming houses of wartime Georgetown occupy his imagination. Never a strong student, Fitzgerald made poor marks during his 3 years at St. Paul. One might blame his devotion to extracurricular activities, though these offered to Scott certain insights into the adolescent condition that could hardly be gleaned in an algebra text. Never lazy, he was, in fact, one of the most engaged students in the academy, but he only engaged in what interested him. "I wrote all through every class," he later recalled, in the back of my geography book and first-year Latin and on the margins of themes and declensions and mathematical problems. Concerned with Scott's low scores, Molly and Edward agreed that he needed a greater academic challenge and more discipline. They were determined, despite the cost, absorbed by Molly's mother, to send him east to finish school. 15-year-old Scott, already a secret smoker and a connoisseur of kissing games, welcomed the change. Summit Avenue's store of experiences had grown threadbare. His new academic home, the Newman School, resided on the fringes of Hackensack, New Jersey, less than an hour in the underground from New York City. The Newman School, self-styled as a Catholic Andover, emphasized a lay education that prepared students for entree to Princeton or Yale rather than priest-ridden Georgetown or Boston College. A tiny scholastic village housing but 60 students, Newman nevertheless enjoyed a reputation for quality, drawing its classes, as one prep publication put it, from the Roman Catholic families of wealth in all parts of the United States. Fitzgerald, anticipating weekend excursions to Broadway musicals, a fresh audience to measure the growth of his emerging talents, and the ever-fleeting promise of football fame, headed east with the hazy sense that an imminent, if not yet defined, glory there awaited his arrival. Years later, he recalled clearly the inventory of assets that he brought to Newman. "I had a definite philosophy which was a sort of aristocratic egotism. I considered that I was a fortunate youth capable of expansion to any extent for good or evil. I based this, not on latent strength, but upon facility and superior mentality. I thought there was nothing I could not do, except perhaps become a mechanical genius. Still, I traced special lines in which I considered I must excel, even in the eyes of others. First, physically. I marked myself handsome, of great athletic possibilities, and an extremely good dancer. Here I gave myself about 80%. Second, socially. In this respect, my condition was, perhaps, most dangerous, for I was convinced that I had personality, charm, magnetism, poise, and the ability to dominate others. Also, I was sure that I exercised a subtle fascination over women. Third, mentally. Here I was sure that I had a clear field in the world. I was vain of having so much, of being so talented, ingenuous, ingenious, and quick to learn." He then owned up to a host of liabilities. "To balance this, I had several things on the other side. First, morally. I thought I was rather worse than most boys, due to latent unscrupulousness and the desire to influence people in some way, even for evil. I knew I was rather cold, capable of being cruel, lacked a sense of honor, and was mordantly selfish. Second, psychologically. Much as I influenced others, I was by no means the captain of my fate. I had a curious cross-section of weakness running through my character. I was liable to be swept off my poise into a timid stupidity. I knew I was fresh and not popular with older boys. I knew I was completely the slave of my own moods, and often dropped into a surly sensitiveness most unprepossessing to others. Third, generally, I knew that at bottom I lacked the essentials. At the last crisis, I knew I had no real courage, perseverance, or self-respect." Taken altogether, Fitzgerald luxuriated in his prospects at Newman, a sunny premonition, perhaps, of the special fate he believed certain to befall him there. "I should say that underneath the whole thing," he remembered of that pregnant period, "lay a sense of infinite possibilities." It was only too predictable, however, that the Newman School never equaled Fitzgerald's impossible expectations. His steady diet of literary juvenilia, including the college life narratives of C.M. Flandreau and W.J. Lynch, Princeton stories, fed an imagination larger than its surroundings. Years later, in what reads like an autobiographical passage, Fitzgerald wrote of one of his characters having lived with such intensity on so many stories of boarding school life that, far from being homesick, he had a feeling of recognition and familiarity. To the extent that Scott experienced a similar sensation at Newman, his confidence was qualified by repeating a humbling pattern of bragging to peers and coming up short on the football field. "He was unpopular starting out," recalled his classmate Charles Donahoe, "partly because his good looks promoted classification as a sissy, which was reinforced by a lack of physical courage. But he had an insight into character and motive which enabled him to more than hold his own in worldly disputes, and finally, by practice, I suppose, he became inured to psychological impacts with either the school authorities or the more important of his fellow students, which in time won him a sense of belonging where his talents had some acclaim." G. Ingersoll Lewis, a female childhood friend of Scott's, deepens this portrait, recalling his ability to overcome ostracism through practiced social skills. Such became his habit of exercising good manners as a kind of currency to pry open otherwise closed doors. As a St. Paulian, Lewis explained, Scott didn't figure at all in the Summit Avenue gang one way or another. But going to Newman increased interest all around. Later he seemed sort of stylish. He had been away to boarding school, which few others had. He had a line and flattered you, and that began to be fun. By then it was something to say, Scott took me home last night. No doubt he brought to these innocently romantic interludes the knowing attitudes, poses, and lines that he had lifted off of Flandreau and Lynch. They gave him a pseudo-sophistication that aroused the envy of more than one Summit schoolboy. At Newman, Scott stubbornly sought to overcome his fresh boy reputation by winning recognition on the athletic field. In fact, just the opposite happened. Of slight build, shaky coordination, and, as Donahoe and others have put it, suspect physical courage, he faced tall odds. One autumn afternoon, these liabilities caught up with him in a humiliating way. Playing on the defensive side of the ball, he conspicuously avoided an especially jarring tackle and was promptly accused of cowardice. The charge must have stung, given Fitzgerald's reverence for a game he believed telescoped the youth, intensity, and heroism of life. In our own day, football's massive popularity has given it a special cultural prominence that, recent and growing concerns about head trauma notwithstanding, we take for granted. Yet in Fitzgerald's time, it was still a relatively new sport that was looking to gain traction. The violence of the game worried critics and supporters alike, then as it does now, and one of the latter, President Theodore Roosevelt, called a summit of sorts in October 1905 to discuss ways to make it safer. The gathering was prompted in no small part by the alarming fact that more than a dozen collegiate and amateur footballers had died that year as a result of injuries sustained on the field. The meeting initiated a series of rules changes that fundamentally altered the way the sport was played. Legitimized by the presidential-driven improvements, football became increasingly popular on the college circuit and elsewhere. It became the game that Fitzgerald loved. Ashamed to be labeled a quitter by classmates, Scott responded to his mistackled detractors with Football, his first published poem. Appearing in the Newman News, it trafficked in the eminently safe terrain of school spirit. There's the goal now right before you. 10 yards, 5 yards, bless your name. Oh, you Newman, 1911, you know how to play the game. The ballad served further to wishfully revise the circumstances of Scott's recent public shame. See that halfback gaining up behind him slow, crash, they're down, he threw him nicely, classy tackle hard and low. The poem, or rather the positive attention it aroused, impressed Fitzgerald. For the first time, he began to discover social acclaim in an activity for which, unlike either academics or athletics, he demonstrated a blossoming talent. Thus, despite a frustrating first semester of fistfights and cold-shouldering, loneliness, and poor grades, he returned to St. Paul for the holiday with a new and important self-awareness. "When I went home that Christmas vacation," he later remembered, "it was in my mind that if you weren't able to function in action, you might at least be able to tell about it, because you felt the same intensity. It was a backdoor way out of facing reality." Put another way, Fitzgerald never quite experienced anything fully until he had written about it. Scott's second and final year at Newman proved less volatile than the first. He began to settle down emotionally, improved academically, and even managed to shine at a track and field meet. At 5 feet 6 inches tall and 130 pounds, with stubby limbs and an uncooperative stride, Fitzgerald was far from a natural athlete. What small gridiron success he experienced, and he managed in his second year as a substitute back to receive some modest acclaim in the school paper, came from sheer will. One observer noted that he had a desperate, bent-forward, short-legged, scuttling way of running with the ball, but somehow it conveyed emotion, and when he was good it was thrilling, and when he was bad, as often as he was, you had to look away from his visible shame. As Scott's illusions of athletic prowess faded, he discovered his first real intellectual guide in Father Sigourney Webster Fay. Father Fay, in his late 30s at the time, gave to Catholicism all the romance and vitality that Fitzgerald had found wanting in black-clad St. Paul. Porcine, perfumed, and something of a dandy, Fay devoted himself to the study of medieval church history, enjoyed a wide circle of Catholic and non-Catholic connections, and lived as much of the life of an aesthete as a priest on a generous private income could. Born in Philadelphia to an Irish-American father and a Bucks County mother with ties to the old Delaware Valley landed gentry, Fay graduated from the University of Pennsylvania and the Episcopal Divinity School in Philadelphia. From there, he taught moral theology at an Anglican seminary near Milwaukee, where he joined the Companions of the Holy Savior. This core of ultra-high church Anglo-Episcopal clergy was attracted to the quasi-monastic culture of vespers and vestments, incense and chants, then so much in vogue among the English Oxford movement. As romantic critics of liberal theology, they called on Anglicanism to recover the sacred ceremonial traditions and rituals of Christianity lost in the Reformation, in effect to reverse Protestant positivism. In 1908, a concerned General Convention of the Episcopal Church moved to rein in the Companions' activities. In protest, Fay converted to Catholicism. Ordained in 1910, Fay taught liturgy and ecclesiastical Greek at Catholic University in Washington, D.C. until the First World War. In November 1912, he was appointed to the Newman Board, in which capacity he met Fitzgerald. Fay made a striking, even revelatory impact on the susceptible 16-year-old. The dour Minnesota priests and celibate nunnery that constituted Scott's human contact with the church left him completely unprepared for Fay's bon vivant. A friend to Henry Adams, a discerning reader of Oscar Wilde's Faustian prose, and a knowledgeable commentator of medieval art, music, and philosophy, Fay gave the impression of effortlessly merging Epicurean pleasures with serious intellectual pursuits. He was a learned man with much of the delightful child about him, recalled Fay's friend Margaret Chandler. He combined spiritual with temporal gifts, for he preached admirably and could bring fire from heaven to kindle the hearts of his hearers, but he was no ascetic and clearly loved good company, good food, and drink. Donahoe remembered the cleric well, and added of his appealing ecumenicalism, "Father Fay possessed the unique advantage as a convert and a priest of not being too tightly bound by loyalty to a creed into which he had come voluntarily, and yet at the same time able to trace his own convictions with intelligence." Fay indulged Scott's impulsive moods and literary ambitions while giving a romantic sheen to his Catholic Celtic identity. Fay flattered his protege, made him feel part of a bigger world of ideas, and asked for nothing more than friendship. "He took easily to boys of the type of Fitzgerald," recalled one of Scott's Newman companions. "He had, too, the gift of being as young as several of the boys he especially cared for." Fay's correspondence with Scott grew increasingly intimate, taking on a dramatic, virtually play-acting quality. During the First World War, by which time Scott had matriculated to Princeton, Fay encouraged their taking on a secret, and he claimed State Department-backed, mission to Russia, where they would work to unite Catholics following the collapse of the Tsarist government. "You will have to take plenty of warm clothes, as we shall be in a very cold climate most of the time," Fay wrote Scott. "Now do be discreet about what you say to anybody. If anybody asks, you say you are going as secretary to a Red Cross commission." Scott went so far as to acquire a passport, though the mission predictably never came off. Fay had looked forward to sharing a room in Russia with Fitzgerald. "It will save some money, at least, and give us a chance to talk the things over which must be strictly confidential between us." And his contributions to their correspondence might be read as a series of veiled love letters. He thought of their relationship as reciprocal. They shared certain rare and altogether enviable traits. "We're extraordinary, we're clever. We could be said, I suppose, to be brilliant." And, Fay liked to presume, a distinct emotional bond. "I never deny that I need you boys, your companionship and all that, but I am also coming to the conclusion that you need a little touch of me, and I do hope, if you get leave, you will fly to my paternal arms." Fitzgerald seemed oblivious to the older man's innuendo, and in any case he detected in Fay the same man-versus-the-modern quality that he admired in his father. For Scott, the few, the well-mannered, and the interesting occupied one distinct sphere and were always on the edge of annihilation by the many, the coarse, and the dull. Later, in tracing the roots of this chip-on-a-shoulder, pull-for-the-underdog complex, Fitzgerald recalled his initial childhood brush with injustice. "First, there was a book that was, I think, one of the big sensations of my life. It was nothing but a nursery book, but it filled me with the saddest and most yearning emotion. It was about a fight that the large animals, like the elephant, had with the small animals, like the fox. The small animals won the first battle, but the elephants and lions and tigers finally overcame them." The author was prejudiced in favor of the large animals, but my sentiment was all with the small ones. I wonder if even then I had a sense of the wearing down power of big, respectable people. I can almost weep now when I think of that poor fox, the leader. The fox has somehow.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.